Dear students and friends, the topic for my class series today is obstructed labor. This is a clinical entity which is rarely seen nowadays in the 21st century. It is because of various innovations in healthcare which have led to better management and care in labor. But rarely we do see cases in the rural areas. Those women who have had no antenatal care or who have reported in advanced labor or have been referred late may end up in obstructed labor. So I am presenting an overview of obstructed labor. In this, I would include the definition in brief about the mechanism of labor, then the various causes responsible for obstructed labor, and lastly, the prevention and management. I begin with this quote: "The bravest battle that was ever fought. Shall I tell you where and when? On the maps of the world, you will find it not. It was fought by mothers of men." So this is true for the olden era, when if a woman was in labor, had to deliver vaginally. So if she had any complication like a big baby, or if she went in obstructed labor, it was really like a battle. And this battle at times did end in death of the mother or the baby. Obstructed labor is a major failure of obstetric care. It is a big problem, especially in the developing countries where antenatal care is not adequate, or access to antenatal care is late, there are late referrals and unsupervised deliveries. The journey of the fetus through the pelvis, we know, is small, but at times the path may be difficult. It would become stressful then for the obstetrician as well as for the woman. Temptations to expedite vaginal delivery in suboptimal conditions may lead to obstructed labor. Now let us look at some important terms. Normal labor. Normal labor is characterized by an increased frequency intensity of uterine contractions, followed by progressive effacement and dilatation of cervix, which helps in descent of the fetus through the birth canal. It is said to be normal when the fetus presents by vertex, labor starts spontaneously at term, terminates naturally without artificial aid and without complications. So anyway, away from this is abnormal labor. That means if it has been artificially induced or if there is any complication during labor, then it is considered abnormal. The other terms used are dystocia and difficult labor. Then prolonged labor is another term. Labor is said to be prolonged when the combined duration of first and second stage is more than the arbitrary time limit of 18 hours. At times, prolonged labor is responsible for obstructed labor. Now, the three P's, as we used to call it, power, passage, and passenger, are responsible for the whole stages or the whole phase of labor. But nowadays, the fourth dimension, psychology, also has been added. We all know the three stages of labor: first, second, and third stage, followed by one stage of observation for PPH. Now, let us look at the mechanism of normal labor. So, as you can see, the whole process begins with uterine contractions. There is engagement followed by continuous descent. With uterine contractions, there is sufficient cervical dilatation and effacement. Now, when the head reaches the pelvic floor, this is followed by internal rotation. Then delivery of the head, restitution and external rotation, delivery of the body and trunk by lateral flexion. So at any of these phases, if there is obstruction, either due to a big baby or inadequate uterine contractions or obstruction at any level, does lead to obstructed labor. Obstruction is the failure of presenting part to descend in spite of good uterine contractions. If we look at the exact definition, which was given by Phil Pott in 1982, failure of descent of the fetus in the birth canal for mechanical reasons in spite of good uterine contractions is termed as obstructed labor. Obstruction can occur at the pelvic rim, but it may also occur in the pelvic cavity or in the outlet of pelvis. Now, whenever we talk about obstructed labor, the triple obstetric tragedy always comes in our mind. So, Princess Charlotte of England had died after delivering a 9-pound stillbirth following 50 hours of labor. So, labor was prolonged in this case. So, the mother died, who is Prince Charlotte, and then the baby also died, was a stillbirth. Then 3 months later, Sir Richard Crofts committed suicide. This is well known because this death of Princess Charlotte in 1870 changed the whole obstetrics and the way they took obstetrics in England. Now, coming back to historical points, obstructed labor has been studied for over 200 years. William Smellie described constriction ring 200 years back. Danforth gave the idea about Bandel's ring. And subsequently, pioneering works done by Brown, Shaw, Nirula, and Hugginson led to the concepts which we know today. The incidence of obstructed labor is 2 to 5% in developing countries. And because of better labor care and management, it is rarely seen in the developed countries. However, 8% of all maternal deaths in the developing countries are due to obstructed labor. This figure could be an underestimation of problem because deaths due to obstructed labor, if they are not identified earlier, I mean obstruction is not identified, it could be labeled due to other causes like sepsis, PPH, rupture uterus, which are complications of obstruction itself. Delayed complications can occur such as a fistula formation, which may result in extreme morbidity of these women. Obstructed labor accounts for 3 to 5% of emergency admissions in our large hospitals. It is mostly seen in unbooked cases admitted as emergencies in late labor, and it reflects lack of proper perinatal care, not only antenatal, but intranatal, and also lack of transport facilities. It is an arrest of vaginal delivery when the fetus is not able to negotiate the pelvis due to mechanical obstruction or incoordinate uterine contractions in spite of forceful uterine contractions. So this is how the inside of the uterus and vagina looks at the time of labor. If due to some reason the fetus is unable to descend this wide passage which has been created, then it is said to be obstructed. Now the three P's, power, passage, and passenger. So faults at these levels has resulted in obstructed labor. Coming to faults in passage, that is the pelvis, there could be bony contraction. This contracted pelvis either could be congenital or it could be acquired, like in cases of grand mal due to osteomalacia. There could be some tumors in the pelvis or some other bony deformities. Obstruction could be due to soft tissue, like an impacted uterine fibroid. As you can see here, the head is unable to descend because of the fibroid coming in way, or due to the presence of a constriction ring, sacculation of uterus, at times vaginal stenosis, presence of septa and other tumors in the vagina, and even an ovarian neoplasm can cause obstruction. Faults in the passage further could be due to the presence of a rigid cervix, which may occur because of bonization or amputation surgery being performed earlier. Other conditions like a pelvic kidney, tumors of urinary bladder, rectum, even a big vesical calculus can cause obstruction. Now falls with the passenger, that is the baby. The baby could be of large size, so unable to descend. It could be a malpresentation, malposition of labor. Locked twins, when the first baby is breached, that baby has delivered, but the head is inside, which gets interlocked with the forthcoming head of the second baby. Or some fetal anomalies in which the head is too large, like a hydrocephalus, conjoined twins, overall volume is large. Even a smaller baby with absent liquor may cause obstruction. Now, faults in power, incoordinate uterine contractions, hypertonicity of the uterus, or a tonically contracted uterus can cause obstruction. At times, we have heard of obstruction in the third stage of labor, when the placenta is retained inside, and if there is an hourglass contracture due to injudicious use of oxytocin, this is called obstruction of third stage of labor. But in these cases, the baby has already delivered. Now let us come to the pathophysiology. Premature rupture of membranes. When this occurs, after the liquor is drained away, the fibers of the lower part of the uterus consolidate around the neck of the baby before the shoulders, therefore keeping the body of the fetus high up. And this is the formation of a contraction or constriction ring. Other factors could be abnormalities in dilatation, a thick lip of cervix which has not been effaced, slow and protracted dilatation, that is for prolonged first stage of labor, or even prolonged second stage because of obstruction at outlet can cause this condition. Now, in these cases, there's always a danger of uterine rupture. Second complication is a fistula formation. The fetal head gets stuck in the pelvis for a longer time. Parts of the bladder, cervix, vagina, rectum get entrapped between the fetal head and the pelvic bone. This causes excessive pressure on these tissues, which reduces their circulation and oxygenation, and necrosis. Immediate necrosis is not visible till after a few days when the whole tissue has sloughed off, and this could result in formation of a vesicovaginal fistula, a vesicocervical fistula, and a rectovaginal fistula. Let us look at the various anatomical changes which occur in an obstructed labor. Changes do occur in the uterus, in the bladder. In the uterus, there's formation of a pathological retraction ring, which is called as Pandel's ring. Bladder becomes an abdominal organ because the urethra is compressed between the presenting part and symphysis, and the patient fails to empty the bladder. Transverse depression at the junction of superior border of the bladder and the distended lower segment at times is confused with a Pandel's ring. The bladder wall gets traumatized because it gets thinned out. This leads to blood-stained urine, which is the initial finding which may be seen in obstructed labor. Subsequently, as I told you, genitourinary fistula forms. Now let us look at these two conditions, the retraction ring and the constriction ring. In normal labor, at the junction between the upper segment and thin lower segment, a ring is formed, which is known as contraction ring. But in abnormal labor or obstructed labor, this ring is known as a retraction ring or a pathological ring or the Pandel's ring. The level subsequently rises till the upper segment becomes thick and the lower segment becomes thin and ballooned out. These are the differences between a constriction ring and retraction ring. A constriction ring is a manifestation of localized incoordinate uterine action, which is there for that period of time. It is due to irritability of uterus. It is at the junction of upper and lower segment. The upper segment contracts and retracts with relaxation. But polarity is abnormal. Maternal condition with this ring remains uninfected unless labor is prolonged. The uterus feels normal. It is not tender. Fetal parts are easily felt and this ring is not felt. On vaginal examination, the lower segment is not pressed by the presenting part. And this ring is usually felt above the fetal head. But a retraction ring is the end result of an abnormal uterine contraction. So there is contraction and not much of retraction. It is followed by obstructed labor. This is usually situated in the lower segment and the position progressively moves upwards. The upper segment is tonically contracted with no relaxation. The wall becomes thicker and thicker and the lower segment becomes thinned out and distended. Maternal condition, the mother becomes exhausted and signs of sepsis begin to appear. The uterus is tense and tender. It is not easily felt. Fetal parts, ring is felt as a groove placed obliquely. Round ligaments are taut and tender and because of delay, usually the fetal heart sounds initially become tachycardic and subsequently are absent. Lower segment is very much pressed by the forcibly driven presenting part. Ring cannot be felt vaginally, but features of obstructed labor are evident and therefore it can be diagnosed as a retraction ring. So as you can see in this picture, this is the normal shape of abdomen, but here is the formation of a Bandel's ring or a retraction ring, retracted thick upper segment and distended lower segment. This is what happens in normal labor, the junction between the upper and lower segments. This could be a constriction ring, but in obstructed labor, this ring subsequently goes up to a higher level. And here you can see a distended bladder. This is the Bandel's ring. Now let us look at the clinical features and diagnosis. So in most of these cases, labor is prolonged. In a grand multiparous woman, labor may be quickly and relatively prolonged because of malpresentation such as transverse lag and obstructed labor may rapidly occur. If you look at the general condition, there's maternal exhaustion, dehydration, and ketoacidosis. You can see sunken eyes, patient has lots of thirst, dry mouth, dry skin, may have sepsis, so may have fever. There would be abdominal pain. If there is shock, a weak rapid pulse, confusion, and unconsciousness, always suspect uterine rupture, which is a subsequent event, and there could be decreased urine output. If you examine on inspection, Bandel's ring can be identified as a depression between the upper and lower segments. When it becomes visible and palpable during labor, it is a late sign and you can feel a full bladder in the lower abdomen. You can see and feel. On palpation, incoordinate and dysfunctional uterine contractions would be seen. Widest diameter of the fetal head would be felt above the pelvic rim. There would be colicky pain and persistent suprapubic tenderness. A tender uterus means there is impending rupture, and at times we can identify either an abnormal presentation or a large size baby. Fetal heart sounds may not be localized or there may be fetal stress. In these cases, doing a vaginal examination is essential, and the initial step is catheterization of the bladder, which is full. May be difficult to catheterize because the urethra is compressed. So you need to push the presenting part high up, relieve pressure on the urethra, and then catheterize. Scanty hematuric urine may be obtained. There may be edema of vulva, a hot dry vagina. There could be edema of cervix. If there is rupture, you can feel a loose hanging cervix, a cervix which is not well applied to the fetal head. At times, the cervix could be uneffaced as well. Occasionally, you can find an incompletely dilated cervix or a rigid cervix, which is responsible for this obstruction. There could be false smelling meconium, labor liquor drained away because of prolonged labor, varying degree of caput, even up to the vulva. And sutures may be unidentifiable. The head usually is seen above zero station. It is an unengaged head. If there is sudden bleeding PV, it does denote that rupture uterus has occurred. The cause of obstruction needs to be identified in all these cases. It could be a big baby, and then you would find a molded head. Or if there is malpresentation, you can feel a shoulder, bro, or a compound presentation, etc. The typical presentation of an obstructed labor is a woman who has an exhausted, toxic look, is in labor for a long time. There is dehydration, tachycardia, fever, a tonically contracted uterus, an overstretched lower segment, and a Bandel's ring, which may be visible. Threatened rupture, signs could be there. There would be no lycor, a large caput, and FHS, fetal heart sounds not localized. Always suspect obstruction when the cervix does not dilate in spite of good contractions. There is molding and caput, but the baby's head fails to descend. Patient becomes increasingly anxious and restless. There are hypertonic contractions and there is poor relaxation between them. Other signs for suspecting obstruction could be a stretched lower uterine segment, the presence of bloody urine, unexpected easy dislodgement of the head followed by a gush of vaginal bleeding, cervix not well applied. However, in these cases, if you identify a Bandel's ring, that is a sure shot diagnosis that obstruction has occurred. Now, let us look at the management. Management includes general management and definitive treatment. As the patient is in shock, we need to resuscitate her first, rehydrate the patient. The aim is to maintain normal plasma volume and prevent dehydration, ketoacidosis. An 80 gauze IV line is started. If she is in shock, give IV fluids, normal saline or ringer lactate, 1 liter every 20 minutes till pulse comes down to less than 90 and a systolic BP rises above 100 millimeters of mercury. We need to use these fluids with caution, especially if they are given too fast, they may cause pulmonary edema. So once her blood pressure has risen, these fluids are decreased and along with that, Lasix is given. Some investigations need to be sent, blood grouping, cross matching, CBC, urea electrolytes, and an ultrasound to localize fetal heart and confirm presentation. Antibiotics, a triad including ampicillin, gentamicin, and metronidazole is essential. We can give higher antibiotics, especially third generation cephalosporins, if you suspect sepsis. The sepsis 6 bundle is to be started. Blood transfusion, if needed, but blood should be cross-matched, and it is essential to send a vaginal and blood culture for sensitivity in these cases. There are some precautions. So once you have identified that she's in obstructed labor, do not use oxytocin drip. Do not try internal version. Never try to do an operative vaginal delivery. If you feel impending rupture is there, always go for a laparotomy. Never try to remove a fibroid at cesarean section unless it was pre-planned. Prevention in most cases of obstructed labor can be prevented, and therefore prevention is always better than cure. Good nutrition in childhood so that the mothers reach their genetically determined height and their pelvis a genetically determined size. Promotion of appropriate and accessible antenatal care with healthcare providers trained in history and physical examination skills. Use of a partograph in labor when the woman is in labor. With the help of a partograph, we can easily identify that labor is prolonged and some other measures need to be taken to deliver the baby. Development of an appropriate and timely referral system is also important. The standard procedure for obstructed labor is a cesarean section when the diagnosis has been confirmed. Now, a prolonged or neglected obstructed labor could be there with an intact uterus, or there could be a rupture uterus. If the uterus is intact and the fetus is alive, the woman should be prepared for delivery with simultaneous attention to sequelae of prolonged labor. So fluid electrolyte imbalance needs to be corrected. We need to prevent and manage infections with broad spectrum antibiotics. We need to consider the method of delivery. If the patient is in full dilatation and if you feel that the use of vacuum extraction or forceps can help in delivering and there are no signs of rupture uterus, they can be tried. In some situations, a symphysiotomy gives an additional space of 2 centimeters and would help in delivery of an obstructed head. But all these measures have to be taken by a specialist. Now, second situation, if the fetus is dead, destructive operations may be considered, particularly if the mother's condition is morbid. Resuscitation of the mother is essential before proceeding with any destructive procedure. Resuscitation, the same, correction of fluid electrolyte imbalance, control of infection. And if you perform destructive operations, we need to be careful as they too may cause rupture uterus. So be prepared, and if PPH occurs, prevent and treat PPH. Nowadays, less of destructive operations are being performed and it is better to go directly for a laparotomy and a cesarean section. Now let us look at cases in which prolonged neglected obstructed labor is there and the uterus is also ruptured. Prompt management of hypovolemia and laparotomy. Remove the fetus and placenta and secure hemostasis. Deliver the uterus out of the abdominal incision. Assistant's hand may hold the uterus with fingers and thumb to occlude uterine vessels. Control the bleeding edges of the uterine laceration with the ring's forceps. So the site where rupture has occurred, that site needs to be identified and needs to be repaired. So till you're repairing the lacerations of the uterus, manual compression of aorta may help in decreasing blood loss and it would help in identifying extent of lacerations. Sometimes you may resort to uterine artery ligation to reduce blood loss before proceeding to definitive surgery. At times there could be excessive blood loss and internal iliac artery ligation may be necessary. Before carrying out any surgical procedure, the course of the ureter should be identified to avoid uretric injury. So either we can do a repair or we can do an obstetric hysterectomy. In all such cases, because of disturbed anatomy, the ureter could be very close to the uterus, and at the time of performing any surgical procedure, always look for the ureter, try to identify its course and then proceed. The integrity of bladder should also be carefully reviewed because the bladder wall may frequently be involved in lower segment rupture. The various surgical operations, the choice of the operative procedure is dependent on various factors, the woman's condition, type of rupture, facilities available, and the experience of the surgeon. You can perform a total hysterectomy, a subtotal hysterectomy, a laceration repair with tubal ligation, or a laceration repair alone. These are the list of destructive procedures: craniotomy, decapitation, evisceration, cladiotomy, that is deliberate clavicular fracture. Craniotomy is the most common destructive procedure and the main indication is hydrocephalus. So the baby's head is too big, that is preventing it from coming down. So we evacuate the contents of the fetal head and then deliver the baby. Performance of destructive fetal operation again depends on local facilities and experience. Before performing any destructive procedure, it is important to ensure that the bladder is empty. The aim of treatment is to deliver the mother by the safest possible method. Operative vaginal delivery and destructive procedures must be performed in operating theater where a set of laparotomy instruments are available for immediate use. So management depending on the fetal condition, but you need to always remember maternal condition remains the first priority. If the fetus is alive, we can attempt vaginal delivery if possible. Otherwise, always go for a cesarean section. But if the fetus is dead, again, can consider destructive operations. But if expertise is not there, always go for a cesarean section. Some common problems which may arise while doing a cesarean section in these cases: problems in anesthesia due to hypothermia, dehydration, ketoacidosis. Patient may not be nil by mouth and may need RT insertion. There could be electrolyte imbalance. These all need to be managed. On opening the abdomen, the type, you can open the abdomen vertically, because at times you may need more space to deliver the uterus out and to repair it or to perform a obstetric hysterectomy. So instead of taking the transverse incision, it is better to go for a vertical incision. Trauma to the bladder may occur because we know the bladder is high up to the level of Bandel's ring. So while opening the peritoneum, you need to be careful. There could be difficulty in opening of the peritoneum because again, the peritoneum could be high up. There may be lower segment hematoma or a ruptured uterus, which needs to be identified and then treatment accordingly. Lower segment incision should be given as high up as possible because a thin lower segment may be damaged and there could be extension laterally involving the uterine vessels if the lower segment is too thin. There could be difficulty in extraction of the fetus. The fetus may be deep down and it would be difficult to deliver the head. In these cases, either the push technique or the pull technique is to be adopted. There could be suturing difficulty due to exteriorization of uterus. Do exteriorization of uterus after delivering the placenta. Evaluate the tears and lacerations. There is difficulty in approximating lower and upper edges, especially if the lower edge is thin and the upper edge is too thick. But the main aim is to achieve hemostasis. In all such cases, once you've delivered the baby, there are chances that the uterus becomes atonic. And there could be atonic PPH and excessive bleeding, which can be lethal and needs to be controlled. Or there could be extension of tears and that could cause traumatic PPH. A quick decision in the golden hour would help in saving this mother. Uterine artery ligation, internal iliac ligation, B Lynch or Chow sutures all need to be tried. And if not possible to control bleeding in the golden hour, then always resort to hysterectomy. Post-operatively, these women should be managed in a critical care line in an intensive care unit. An abdominal drain should be left if needed. Now, because of necrosis, there could be a fistula formation. In order to prevent that, at times we can put an indwelling catheter for 7 to 10 days so that bladder is at rest. Higher antibiotics and electrolyte management still needs to be done. We must always consider for thromboprophylaxis in these cases. Prevention is always better than cure. And these are the ways we can prevent obstructed labor from occurring. From history itself, try to assess for high-risk factors depending on her age, height, gait, disability, which may affect her pelvis and lower limbs. Ask for history of osteomalacia or previous pelvic injury. If there is a previous stillbirth or neonatal death, be cautious. Length of previous labor needs to be inquired and the reason for previous operative delivery. Examination to assess fetopelvic relationship in early labor is essential. See for early signs of obstructed labor, slow progress and prolonged labor, which can be very easily identified if you plot a partograph. So plotting of a partograph in all cases of labor is essential to identify the various complications which may occur. This you can see a partograph of a case of obstructed labor. This woman came in 4 centimeters dilatation at 10 hours. Then subsequently at 14 hours, dilatation increased to 5 centimeters. Then at 16 hours, it remained 5 centimeters. So as you can see here, there are good uterine contractions. In spite of good contractions, dilatation did not increase, and the station of fetal head, which was at -3/5, remained the same. So this is a typical case of obstructed labor. And as the graft has gone beyond action line, it means some action has to be taken. Cesarean section was done, and a baby weighing 4.6 kg was delivered. So this is how, by plotting a partograph, you can easily prevent obstructive labor. In all cases of floating head, pendulous abdomen, occipito-posterior position, premature rupture of membranes, premature bearing down, cases of drained lica, repeatedly are having a full bladder, and cases of fetal distress, always think that there could be some factor responsible for this. There could be some complication which may occur, and always plot a partograph in active labor. Delay in management of obstructed labor at periphery can be understood by this model system. There are socioeconomic and cultural factors which cause delay in decision to seek care. Accessibility to facilities, especially medical facilities, and quality of care. All these are responsible to delay the decision to seek care. If facilities are not available, then delay in identifying and reacting to the problem. Quality of care may not be appropriate. The first two delays relate to issues of access to care, factors in family, community, and transport. And the third delay relates to factors in the health facility. So if these women can seek care earlier, can be identified at an early phase, and if they can be early referral to an appropriate health facility, a tertiary care center in obstructed labor, then that would help in reducing maternal deaths. Let us look at the various complications in sequelae. Maternal complications immediate are rupture uterus, genital tract trauma, PPH, shock, death. Delayed complications, puberal infection, endometritis, septicemia, urinary fistula, subinvolution, thrombophlebitis, delayed healing of wound, some obstetric palsies because of prolonged compression on the nerves, more chances of postpartum psychosis. There could be future obstetric complication, persistent anemia, and severe PPH can lead to Sheehan syndrome. Fetal complications include asphyxia, hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, sepsis, death, intracranial hemorrhage, trauma, and at times late neurological sequelae and cerebral palsy. So the take-home message is proper management of normal labor is essential to prevent obstructed labor. Continuous and thorough assessment of a woman and her fetus contributes to limit negative outcomes by providing opportunity for timely and appropriate treatment. If obstructed labor is identified, prompt treatment is required to save the life of the woman. It is not always possible to save the life of the fetus. Thank you for a patient listening.